Hey guys, Todd here with HobbyLink Japan, and in today's episode of Mobile Suits that we probably figured we'd never see in kit form, we've got the NRX-055 bound dock from the series Zeta Gundam. So yes, it's one of those kits that we really, if you saw on TV a long time ago, and you probably never really expected Bandai to ever get around to actually making this mobile suit in kit form. But yet here it is, the year 2020, and we finally do have a bound dock in the HG Universal Century line of kits. All right, so yeah, when this kit went up for pre-order, when it was announced, I was a bit excited because I tend to like these kind of more esoteric, unusual type of model kits, and this is definitely right up there with them, and probably one of the strangest mobile suits that they have actually ever produced in kit form. And not only do we have it in kit form, but this thing is, as you can tell by that box behind the kit rotating around, this thing came in a rather large size box. It's about the same diameter as you would expect for a Master Grade kit. I do believe the RX-78 3.0 came in about the same size box as this guy, and I guess that's kind of to be expected. It might be hard to tell by that thing just sitting there turning it around on the turntable, but this guy, he is a bit of a big kit. Just how big, you might be wondering. Well, I brought along my trusty Revive RX-72 HG kit here so we can do a nice size comparison. And let me go ahead and put him here on the turntable next to this kit. And there you can see just how much larger this bound dock is compared to a standard HG RX-78. So yes, he is definitely head and shoulders above the rest, or at least above this RX-78. Yeah, he's quite a big guy. Let's put this guy right directly in front so you can see, get a good angle there. Yeah, you can see just how much larger this bound dock is compared to the RX-78. So he is a big boy, most definitely. So if you're wondering why this HG is a bit more expensive than a standard HG, that is definitely going to be why. So you get a lot of plastic with this kit because some of these pieces are quite large, especially this midsection here. This skirt, as you can see, these purple pieces, they are really, really, really quite large. Hey, let's put this guy standing sideways next to that skirt there. Yeah, the skirt itself is longer than the RX-78. Now, it is a big, long kind of flat piece, but I do have to say, let me go ahead and pick this guy up for a second here. Let's get a good upskirt view of this guy. Because, yeah, there is not really much going on underneath his skirt there. So you got a rather anemic kind of waist unit there. Not really too much to it. And it's just a whole lot of emptiness going on underneath there. You do have these verniers here on the back of the skirt. And they are able to rotate around as well as flex a bit because they are positioned on the ball joints there, and the one in the center also can rotate around, actually, and a little bit side to side as well as up and down. So you are able to position these verniers in some unique positions if you would like to do so. So there you've got the nice upskirt view for this guy. So let me talk about the colors for this guy, because that was another thing that I saw the images initially, and I probably wasn't exactly expecting the colors that this kit came molded in. This is, I'm actually looking at the viewer for the camera here as it's recording it, I don't think it really truly picks up the pink color as accurately as what I am seeing with my own eyes here. This guy, this kit is molded in probably one, has to be the hottest pink Gundam kit that I have ever assembled. That pink is like 1990s, or was it the late 80s, 90s, when you had all those really hot colors, hot pink colors and whatnot that were quite popular. It really reminds me of back in those days. You had those Trapper Keeper folders and they had all those kind of crazy colors. This is definitely like that. And then you got those really bright yellows. It's not just like your standard yellow like we would see on such on like an RX 78. He's got some really fluorescent kind of bright yellows going on with this kit as well. Kind of a more fluorescent type of green going on for those pipes. Now the purples are more subdued. The purples are just your standard kind of purple color. And of course the inner frame there is just your standard kind of inner frame gray. So there's not a whole lot going on in terms of the color for the frame there. Now, one good thing about this kit, I do have to say, is they are also continuing on their more recent, it seems like it's a bit more of a more recent kind of trend of having different colors where you would they would have like the holes on the outside of the plastic, and when you sandwich the pieces together, you would actually see the colors for a different color plastic underneath. So you don't actually have to apply a whole lot of stickers to this kit because they do actually a lot of the different colored pieces here are actually molded in color. So like here on the side of his hand claw, that yellow you're seeing right here, that is actually yellow plastic pieces underneath, not a sticker. So that looks quite nice. There are a few stickers that you do have to apply. And here we go again. We see these this pink kind of poking through the front of the skirt there. Thankfully, that is not a sticker because I really hate applying stickers onto these kind of vented, slatted type of slots there. Always never really looks that great. And even here, there's one more that I'm gonna pick him up here and show it off. Here on his knee, this yellow one here, this is actually a yellow plastic piece as well. But there are some stickers and you do have to apply a few. So actually the most that you were applying are these four here on the front of the leg, these tiny little triangles towards the bottom of both the left and right legs, as well as on his head up here. You see those two yellow pieces? Those two are also going to be stickers. And there is one last sticker that you are going to have to be applying to this kit, and that is going to be the little tiny green mono eye in the center of his face. Let's go ahead and pick him up, see if I can get a close up, see if we can get some light reflecting off of that mono eye underneath. There you can kind of get a good view of it. So he is a Xeon type of mobile suit there, and he does have his little mono eye, so that's quite cool. So there we have it for talking about the colors, the stickers, and some of the color separation going on for this kit. All right, so also I do want to point out, speaking of that type of subject here, all of these green pieces here, this runner was like a really soft type of rubber type material. So it's not a hard type of plastic for these pipes, and you do kind of have to bend them around when you are putting this it together, but it is not something that is terribly too difficult, and the effect actually looks quite nice once you got this guy all put together there. Those pipes look, they do look nice. Now, because of this this type of rubber material, since this kit is still brand new, it hasn't been subject to the environment for such a long time, I'm always, whenever I see these kind of more rubbery type of pieces, I'm always a little bit more hesitant about the longevity for those type of pieces, because I know the rubbers, they tend to kind of crack over time, or they'll discolor depending on the environment that they've been subjected to. I don't know if UV lights are going to end up discoloring them at some point in the future or not, but we'll have to see. I do wonder how long these little kind of rubber pieces, how long they'll look as fresh as they do now, and if they will eventually crack and break at some point in the future. But that will be something that we'll just have to wait and see in the years down the line. Hopefully they'll stay good for quite a long time. I do hope so. We'll just have to see. All right, let's move on then, and let's talk about maybe looking at a little bit of his articulation, how he can move. So of course, this bound dock also has a transformation that it can do. I believe it is called the MA mode. So we'll be looking at that towards the end of the video, and it's kind of cool. He looks like a flying half egg or a flying little submarine So because of that, you kind of end up getting a little bit more articulation in terms of parts where it's going to end up transforming later anyway. So here on the feet, actually, when it's transformed into the into that kind of flying mode, or the MA mode, the feet end up becoming claws on the side. So yeah, even though they look like feet now in his mobile suit standing mode, they do become claws, so you end up... So that's the reason why there is quite a bit of articulation going on with these toes. You can kind of bend them up, you can kind of bend them down. You can do all kinds of sorts of crazy stuff. And then you got a ball joint there at the top of the foot, which is going to allow you to position that around a little bit. And here at the back of the legs, you can see more of those green pipes that I was talking about there. And his leg is going to be able to bend up quite a bit if you would like to do that, if you're crazy enough to. Now, because it does have the skirt, maybe we're not going to be able to bend the legs out so much. However, you do have these slotted flaps on the side, and this is going to be when he's in the MA mode. The legs are kind of going to be poking forward through those slots. So that's the reason for those doors there. But they also do allow you to kind of get the legs in a position a little bit more than you would be able to if that wasn't there. All right, so moving on next up to the torso. So as you can see, we looked at the bottom side of that skirt earlier. So let's take a look at this top side here. There is a rather large open trench here in the back of this upper skirt. And with this torso, you are able to kind of bend him back a little bit. You can do that if you would like, and you would be able to twist him left and right. So you can do that. His arms are pretty much standard fare for an HG kit. Nothing terribly too fancy here. There we go. That elbow, though, is not looking like it is double jointed. So maybe you can only going to be able to get up to a 90 degree bend there for that upper joint here. However, he does actually have kind of two elbows going on. Actually, he's got this one here, and then there is another joint right there. So two places that you can actually flex that arm. And the hand actually has a separate thumb piece, which you don't really see too much actually on HG kits, I think. But the other fingers, they are in a fixed pose. Now, you did probably notice earlier that the left and right arms, they are actually different. So you're not building identical arms for this guy. His right arm is molded in this nice hot pink plastic compared to the gray for his left arm there. His right arm here does kind of have more of a standard double type of joint going on there for his elbow. And not only that, but his right arm here doesn't have a standard hand like on his left hand. For this one, you do get that claw. So just like we saw for the feet, the claw has different points that you can articulate there for the bottom claws, as well as the top claws. They can bend up and down there on different swivel joints. So that's kind of cool if you would like to use those to grab onto something. And then for the head here, the head is more of a standard neck double ball joint. So you got a ball joint there at the torso part, and then a ball joint up where it connects to the head as well. And then on the neck also, you've got those little rubber green pieces there. So two points of articulation going on there for that head unit. Now also up here on top of his head for these antennas here, they are, let me see if I can pull one of them out of here, and you can see there is a ball joint on the bottom of that antenna. So you can kind of position these antennas around a little bit if you would like to do so. They do move around, so that's always nice for those that would like to position your antennas into different positions. All right, so speaking about the left hand there with the fixed fingers, we do have some other options for his hand. So one of the options they give you here is, let's go ahead and grab this piece. So they do give you, now you only get options, of course, for the left hand, because the right hand you have that claw, but you do have one kind of closed fist option as well. And with this, you're going to need this hand position if you would like to install and use his yes, that's right, he comes with a beam saber. So you actually only get one beam saber handle included into this kit. However, it did come including two actual of the yellow beams. So yellow beams are feel a bit more rare than the standard color beams, and this is a pretty good sized beam. So I'm wondering if I'm going to save this, maybe I can use it with a Gian kit. I wonder, because I think that really, really old Gian kit, it came with a solid colored beam piece and not a translucent yellow beam piece. So this would be really good if you have an older Gian kit. Now the Revive Gian, I think, actually did have a translucent yellow piece, if my memory serves me correct. But if you're looking to help out an older Gian kit, that might come in handy. And there is actually one more hand piece that comes included with this kit, and I have it installed right now on his beam rifle. So it does feel a bit more rare than to see a trigger finger there for the left hand only, since this guy has no right hand. There's only a trigger finger for the left hand, so that actually felt a bit more rare in my opinion. Now for this beam rifle also, there is a clear green plastic piece for the scope on this gun. It's not going to want to focus, and it's going to be really hard to pick that up. Hopefully you guys can kind of see that there. So there we have a beam rifle for this guy. Now that is going to be it, I believe, for looking at this kit in its main mobile suit mode here. So I'm going to go ahead now and transform this guy into the MA mode so we can take a look at that. Actually, I just remembered where that other clear green plastic piece was, and that was going to be here on this. I think this was the scattering mega particle gun. I think that's what they were calling this piece here on his left arm, if my memory serves me correctly. So there it was. I knew there was two. There's one for the gun, and then there's one right here. So really hard to see. All right, so let's go ahead and do the transformation, and so give me a second. All right, so now we've got it all set up in MA mode. And so yes, he's in his little flying submarine type of mode here. And I gotta say, it looks rather cool. It's definitely a unique look for a Gundam kit, not something that you get to build or see every day. One thing I do want to mention before I forget, you will notice that I have him rotating around on a stand. This is one of those free display stands that they had a long time ago as a promotion for Iron-Blooded Orphans kits. This kit does actually come including its own standard display stand, the action base. I think it was 5, I want to say. The single base was the action base 5. Actually, yeah, it does say on the runner there, ACB5, so action base 5. So you do get a clear action base 5 runner here. Now, the reason I tend not to build these and use these when they come with kits is because we have these other runners, and that saves me a little bit of time not having to put these stands together all the time, as well as the fact that I kind of prefer this free Iron-Blooded Orphan stand, because it can sit perfectly in the center of the rotating turntable there, and it's just a straight up peg, not something kind of curved, so it allows me to get a really good angle there for positioning these kits here on the turntable. So that's the reason I tend to use that thing more than anything else. But getting back to talking about the kit, so the guy kind of, he folds down into the hole on the top of the skirt there. You lift up a piece, and then his whole body's able to kind of rotate down underneath. So this is the reason why this skirt, there is nothing included underneath of it. It's just a big empty space. That's because you're going to end up stuffing his entire torso and head and the arm on the underside of this thing. So that's the reason for that. And then the legs, they do kind of bend up, and then you can use those feet there as claws, like I was talking about just a second ago. Now you will notice there is actually a new weapon that has been installed here in this form that was not seen previously, and they are calling this gun the Diffuse Mega Particle Cannon. So that is interesting. And there's also a slot on this MA mode on the side of the skirt that you can plug in the beam rifle there. You see it rotating around there on the right. So you can plug in both the beam rifle as well as that mega particle cannon there on the side. And it looks kind of quite cool with those two weapons included on this thing. And with the kit in this MA mode, actually, you can really get a good look at that included clear green eyepiece there, and that definitely becomes the eye there for this mode. And it looks, yeah, it looks really, really cool. I kind of I had an idea when I was building this kit. If you were to maybe unplug these, the two arms, and then unplug the guns, and just have it just this kind of like submarine looking thing itself, and then just paint it all yellow, you'd have your own little yellow submarine. You can go singing Beatles songs, and that would be look kind of cool. I think we all live in the yellow submarine. If you guys are kind of curious to see the underside of this thing with the whole unit stuffed underneath, let's go ahead and rotate him around so you can get a good look at that, how that looks. You can see he's kind of just turned sideways and just stuffed underneath there. I have those his little antennas kind of positioned around the veneer, the thrusters there, and his arm kind of just bends around forward and gets shoved underneath the front section of that skirt there. So that's kind of interesting how they've got this guy all positioned underneath of him. But yeah, I don't know if I'd want, I was having trouble with this top piece. It was not wanting to stay connected down too well. You can kind of see it starting to poke up here on the top, but I figured that was good enough. Now, speaking, since this is from Zeta Gundam, it wouldn't be a complete review if we don't get an actual Zeta Gundam in here at some point. Ohide-san actually loaned me his Zeta Gundam. He had one at home. I built the revive kit a while ago, and I can't remember where the heck I put this thing. It's probably sitting in a plastic bag somewhere. Ooh, I do remember having to apply those stickers on the back. Yeah, that guy had some nasty stickers on his backpack. Thankfully, there weren't too many stickers included with this bound dog. All right, so that's going to wrap it up then for this look at the NRX-055 Bound Dock HGUC kit from Bandai Hobby. So thank you guys out there very much for watching. And after this kit, yeah, I don't know what the next kit from Bandai Hobby is that will be coming out next month. So we have nothing else coming out here in the month of October. And November, there is the Master Grade Wing Gundam that should be coming out at some time. I don't recall any other HG kits. None of the other HG kits kind of pop into my mind at this time. But hopefully we'll have some more stuff coming here that we can review for you guys. So thanks again very much for watching, and have a great week or day. Yeah.